Rascal, smell that. You don't like that? Hmm. Walnuts. Walnuts fell off of my tree and they're all over the place. And I also have corn husks all over my yard. It looks like a mess, but it's an organic mess. I mowed my lawn. Check it out. I mowed my lawn. It looks really good. And that's one of the things that I was mentioning. Let's go. I was going to do this week. So I got my lawn mowed. And then I took, oops, got to close this. I don't want no stray chickens. And I took a lot, well, actually not a lot, a little, because I have a lot of yard. I took the green grass clippings and I put it in here, like I said I was going to do. And the chickens love that because when I'm on my riding mower, it's like a giant vacuum. It cuts the grass and it sucks it all up into these containers. But out in the yard, there's all kinds of crickets and grasshoppers and moths and all kinds of nature's little children that I suck up. I'm talking. And I bring them in here and I dump them. We're just going to have to deal with it. And then I dump them all over in here and the chickens just loved it. The chickens were like crazy. They were all over the place tossing it. Hey, hi. You want to bite my finger? Hey, turkey. What's that? You don't recognize that. Yeah, those are my friends. Yep. Hi. How you doing? Anyway, unless I have food, they're not my best friends. But anyway, I brought in the greens and I tossed them in here, spread them all out. Ooh. And I tossed the greens in here, so this is all green grass and leaves and bugs, and the chickens were just having the best time of their lives. It was like a blue light special at Kmart. They were jumping all over each other, scratching around, throwing stuff around. It was just mayhem in here. They were getting the bugs, and they were eating all the clover and dandelion greens and leaving the grass. They like grass, but not quite so much as the dandelions and clover, so they had a lot of food. It was like Thanksgiving for those birds and they loved it. So I got a nice green layer in here and it smells really good with that nice fresh grass. But hi, hello there. Yeah, I'm making a video. Is that okay? Yeah. How's my babies doing, huh? Yeah, I'll bring you some food later. Is that okay? Anyway. Oh. This is my life. I love it. I love my life. Hey, yeah, I know. Anyway, this fall I'm going to use the mower and I'm going to crush up dried leaves and bring them in here and mix it in with that. And the dried leaves are what keep the litter and the poop and stuff like that and keep them warm during the winter. This grass is not really what does it. This grass is more like a playground for them right now. Something. Walnuts everywhere. Kind of like this. You know, I could take these inside, dry them out, and then take the coating off the outside, roast them, and have walnuts. But I leave them for the squirrels, and the squirrels really do appreciate it. But boy, I do love the smell of those things. Oh, but anyway, this is my compost pile, and I piled up all that stuff that was in there, and it ended up being this. And I moistened it all down, and then I piled it up. It took me a whole day to do that. That was actually a lot of work. But it's well worth it, because this compost, when it's done cooking, is going to go with me to the new place. Because the new house down in Iowa doesn't have a garden and it doesn't have compost made, and I'm gonna need something for the first year garden. Although it's not gonna be a great garden, it's gonna be a container garden and kind of a, I don't know, just a first year garden, which isn't gonna be that great. Kind of like this garden was the first year. So I'm gonna cook this down, put it in barrels and stash it away and take it with me. Yep. Hey, let's go. Doesn't look like much, does it? Yep, it's just grass, leaves, I don't know what that is. Corn that doesn't get eaten because they only like cracked corn. So the whole corn they leave. And yep, I do eventually have little pieces of corn sprouting up all over my compost, which I think is kind of cool because then I pick out the new corn sprouts and I feed it to the chickens. So, ooh, this is already warming up. I piled this up yesterday and moistened it up and I can feel warmth coming out of it already. Oh, wow. This is nice. It's actually already steaming. Can you see that? Holy Moses. That is actually very, very hot. okay, well, I like. And so the compost is up and running. It doesn't take very long when you're using chicken manure. But any compost, like I say a million times, can be made out of anything. You just pile it all up, keep it moist, and it's gonna cook. So let's leave this to do what it's gonna do, and let's head out to the garden. Leaf? No? What's out there? Huh? And this is where all the compost from the compost pile went. Before I built the compost, I had to clear out the old compost and bring it to the garden. So this is what I was talking about in the last video. Before I could mow my lawn, I had to clear out the chicken coop, and then I had to put the compost over there, bring the old compost over here, and fill these beds up. So after 3 years of gardening at this address, I finally have my beds full of rich, dark, beautiful soil. And then I'm going to move. Yes. But I've mentioned this in comment sections that I'm not taking these raised beds with me. I'm not taking the raised beds. I'm not taking the asparagus beds or the strawberry beds or the new apple trees and plum trees that I planted. I'm going to leave that for the new owners of the home, whoever they may be. Hopefully they're going to enjoy this as much as I have. I mean, it's the most beautiful, amazing soil that I could possibly make for somebody. And no matter what they grow in here, no matter how they choose to grow it, they're going to have some fantastic luck, and I wish them the best of luck in this garden because it's been very good to me and it's been very fun to do. So hopefully they're going to enjoy this as well. And even if they don't decide to use this for gardening, if they decide to tear up the beds, they're going to spread this out on the lawn, and the lawn, their lawn is going to look really, really nice. So either way, it's a win situation for them, but I think that this is going to be a selling point for the house. How many places do you find that have set up working organic gardens that are all ready for you? And I think that's good because a lot of people are starting to turn towards organic gardening because they don't want to hear about all of this stuff that's hurting them in the grocery stores with all the viruses and all the bacteria and all the products that are grown the way that they don't want them to be grown and the lack of vitamins and all that nonsense, you know, that you hear in the news. Growing your stuff your own way is the best way to get what you want inside your body and make yourself, your kids, your family as healthy as possible and as happy as possible, because it's also relaxing, it's good therapeutic, and it's also good exercise. Trust me, my shoulders are sore, and my butt and my legs and things that I didn't know could be sore are sore from all the mowing, all the hauling of the compost, the piling of the compost. It has been a heck of a 2 days, and I feel wonderful. I do. This is a great way to exercise for me. But speaking of, well, actually, there's no segue into this. I noticed that my tomatoes are getting eaten by deer. And that was kind of weird because I've never had deer come into my yard. I know that there's deer out here. I mean, I'm out in farming country. There's going to be a lot of deer in southwest Minnesota. Thing is that they don't normally come into town. And I figured out why. It took me a while to wonder, you know, why are these animals doing what they're doing? Because I needed to understand that. And it turns out, very simple explanation. The farmers plant corn. This is corn country. So there's a lot of corn growing out in the fields, and they alternate. One year they'll grow corn, the next year they'll grow soybeans, because the corn sucks up all the nutrition out of the soil. So what they'll have to do next year is they plant soybeans to throw some nitrogen back into the soil. So they alternate corn, soybeans. Last year was corn, and so there were no deer in my yard whatsoever. This year is all soybeans, as far as the eye can see, soybeans. And from what I've seen, deer don't really like soybeans. And if they do like soybeans, they're not showing it. So what they're doing is they're coming into everybody's yards here and they're eating their bushes. My bushes got topped off, my willows got nibbled on, my tomatoes, they're eating the ripe tomatoes. And yeah, they come in at night and they mow your garden down. And I don't mind having deer in, but I would like a few tomatoes for myself. And they ate my corn too. So I'm gonna pick all of my tomatoes. I know that they're not ripe now, but picking your green tomatoes is not a problem. And there is no weird, crazy formula to ripen your tomatoes. People have asked on various garden forums, how do you ripen tomatoes? I'm scared to pick all my green tomatoes. You know what? It's as easy as this. Pick your tomato. Set it in your house out of direct sunlight. You don't want it in direct sunlight because it's no longer living off the plant. When you have something in direct sunlight, it's going to want to draw in nutrients and stuff, and you don't want to do that. Just pick your tomato, rinse it off gently, set it on the counter. That's all you have to do. Yep. Yeah, you can set it in a paper bag. You can throw an onion in there. You can do all this weird, funky, weird science stuff to it. But I have always just picked my tomatoes. And the way that you know that they're ready to be ripened is, you know how they grow dark green? Well, when they get that lighter green hue to them, they're ready to be ripened. You can pick them, toss them on your counter, and just wait. Just wait, and they're going to be just fine. They're going to turn red. I've been doing this for decades, and it works perfectly. And if you don't want to have all of these tomatoes sitting on your counter, all you have to do is put them in a box somewhere and set them off to the side. Just don't stack them up on top of each other. Give them some air to breathe and stuff, and they're going to be just fine. Your tomatoes are going to ripen inside, and you're not going to come out every morning and find about a half a dozen of them munched on by deer, because deer seem to be really rude guests. They take a bite off of one, they drop it, they take a bite off another, and they drop it. And I know it's deer because I see the deer prints. So yeah, it is deer that are eating my tomatoes. What a pain in the butt. But it's all part of gardening, isn't it? Okay, I'm going to pick my tomatoes, and I'm also going to dig up this plant because I'm really curious to see how the roots look on this plant. And I figure maybe you are too. Let's dig up the tomato plant and see what it looks like. All right. Rascal dog. All right. I just picked all of the tomatoes, and yesterday when I was bringing out compost, I dumped compost in here because I had nowhere else to put it. All the other beds were full. But you know what? I just thought of this just now. I mean, I don't plan anything out. I just thought of this. I was going to yank this plant up off camera, and then I thought, you know, a lot of people may want to take their plants inside, whether it's peppers or tomatoes, whatever it is. You know, you can actually take your tomato plants inside and grow them all winter if you have an indoor grow room like me. And I'm going to show you the way that I would do it. I don't like to dig it up with the soil because this soil, even though it's good, it has all your little creatures, you know, like your beneficials, your worms, your centipedes, all that fun stuff. These are insects and creepy crawlies that you don't want in your house, because along with them, you're going to get things like spider mites, aphids, all kinds of other strange stuff, and you don't need that in your house. So I recommend, this is just my suggestion, if you're going to take a tomato plant in, take it in bare root. That means dig it up, spray it off really good with a water hose, or inside, just flush it with water from top to bottom, and then plant it in soil. And this is how I do it. Rascal. You could just grab it, yank it up, but I prefer to dig it up and then take the soil off. That way, I get every single root I can, and then I can pick and choose what I want to leave on the plant. This is amazing. By the way, this is Boxcar Willie, for those of you who haven't been keeping up on it. This is Boxcar Willie. It is one plant that I planted extremely, oh gosh, where does this thing go? China? Holy Moses. I planted it very deep, and then I allowed it to come up and then grow along the ground and put down roots. People have nicknamed this the Praxis method of growing. I didn't do that myself. They actually gave it that nickname. And I'm kind of flattered because now I have my own method of growing. And I'm getting kind of winded because this is a lot of plant to dig up. It's going to have one heck of a root system. Now, if you didn't want to go to this extreme, you could have your friend do it. Or just yank it up by the roots, because any part of a tomato plant that's buried is going to put down roots. That's why tomato plants are the one most wonderful thing to take in and grow. They will grow as perennials inside. Okay, let's, gosh, I don't know what I'm doing here. Let's see what's underneath here. Shake off the dirt. Just go like this. I know there's probably some kind of weird scientific method, but you know me, Mr. Not Scientific. Take a look at this root system. Is that amazing? Now, when you plant your tomatoes in the spring, you can lay them down, and that's called the trench method. Or you can plant them straight down deep and grow them right up. That is called the deep method. Now, the Praxis method is a combination of those methods. That's the only difference. Now, wish I could get the whole thing up. Please, please, come on. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Well, here's the bottom half where it started way down there. Now, is that a root system? This is why the plants are just so darn healthy, because they have a crazy happy root system that goes down deep, really deep. These aren't shallow roots. And of course, I left a ton of them down there. These are just the ones that I could get up. When you have a root system like that, you can support endless tomatoes. People will say, you need to cut off the suckers and give it strength and focus on just a few tomatoes. Well, you know, I'm here to say you don't have to do that. You don't have to limit yourself in gardening. As long as you like have nice, good, rich, loose soil, and you plant deep, and you have the room for them, there is no limit to what you can do. This plant can hold as much fruit as I want. It can put out as many suckers as it wants because it has the root system to support that kind of a style. Now, as far as taking this inside, here's where it gets delicate. There you go. Take this, hose it down really, really well to make sure there's nothing on these roots, nothing on the stems, no bugs at all. And then we just plant it in a pot, spread the roots out, and bury it like this. And then in time, I'd say maybe a week or two, we're gonna see little buds coming out here, and we're gonna have ourselves a tomato plant. Let's see, do I wanna do that one? Or do I wanna do this one? Or this one? Ooh, this one looks nice, doesn't it? Huh. That's a lot of root system. I'm gonna need a bigger pot for that. You know what? I kinda like the look of this one. What do you think? I know this one looks like it has more roots and stuff, but then again, I like this, that it has a few stocky stems. Let's try this one, okay? I'm gonna take this inside and plant it. So stay tuned on the Voodoo Garden, my other channel, and I'm gonna be doing updates on this all throughout the winter. And let's see if I can get this to grow. I don't know if it'll grow or not. You know, nothing is guaranteed in gardening. You never know. You could have a perfectly healthy plant and it dies, or you could have a really sickly plant and it surprises you and it puts out more food than you ever thought possible from a plant. So we never know what's gonna happen. But this one is my best choice. I'm gonna take this inside and plant it. Having some good times, aren't you? Yes, you are. Well, just wait until we move. You're gonna have 3 acres to patrol. You're gonna love that. Well, folks, I got this, and this is beautiful. I love the roots on this. I hope it grows. I really do, because I was pretty rough on it when I drug it out, but what the heck? If it grows, it grows. If it doesn't, I'm gonna be getting seeds, and I'm gonna be planting these again. By the way, right in the nose. By the way, Boxcar Willie, I'm going to be giving out seeds in the 2013 free seed giveaway in January, because I was so impressed with this for the last couple years that I think that there might be quite a few people out there that would like to try this. If you like a good old-fashioned heirloom tomato that's not like this big, I mean, yeah, those are impressive if you want to think of your successes in terms of size or production. You know, like I got a truckload of tomatoes, I might be a success. I measure my successes by how much fun I have and by the one tomato that's in my hand at that very moment. This is my success for today. And this is gonna be my fun for later on this winter. So whether you're growing one plant, whether you're growing a million plants, it's all a matter, I guess, of what you find your enjoyment. And this is how I find my enjoyment. And we're gonna go inside and we're gonna plant this. But thank you everybody for joining me on this odd little episode. I'll talk to you all soon. Have a great day. Bye. Want to go? Ooh. Tractor. It's huge and it's green. I love farm country. I really do. Okay, let's go. Let's go, little buddy.